us to the word. Let's turn to just a simple verse, Romans chapter 8, verses 28. When you get it, say, still saved. Romans 8, 28. When you get it, say, still saved. Romans 8, 28. I know my electronic people are already there. Romans 8, 28. When you get it, still saved. Everybody still saved? All right. I'm going to read from the King James. You'll know it when you hear it. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Amen. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. Let me just encourage us on this day with just a sermon for that just says, be encouraged. Be encouraged. Let me be clear here, church, that we can sometimes, when we try to do, excuse my words, market salvation, we can tell people of these dreams of life and peace, and because we have given our lives to God, that ain't nothing gonna happen to us.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. This means that the boss that we had trouble with on Friday somehow will vanish on Monday when we go back. Or the family member that was giving us the hardest time, that somehow they'll be out of jail on Monday. Or those things in which we go through, our broken hearts, the sickness, and those things that happen to our bodies, somehow disappear when we say yes to Jesus. That would not be the proper way of looking at this, because we must understand that our biblical journey is wrought with difficulties and transgressions. In fact, we have to be clear here that salvation may increase the challenges that we face in, because we can't give in to what we used to give into. Amen? The things that we have to say no to, and the things that we have to be focused on, and then be concerned about our own insecurities and why we do the things and why we do the tendencies that we do. We have to be even more concerned because now we're living the saved life. Saved life comes with challenges. And we see throughout the Bible the challenges that are faced by these biblical personas, the banishment from the garden, the famine and slavery of Egypt, the lost souls and deaths in that journey through the wilderness, the crossing over into that promised land only to face these significant military battles and internal strife. Then the unification of the kingdom under the expectations of the king Saul, only to see him fall to his human flesh and desires. And then the bright day of David, and now this new king, only to see him again fall to transgressions and then deal with the tragedy of his relationship with Sister Bathsheba. The journey of Israel and Judah into the exile, and even the fast forward to the New Testament, the disciples whose fear placed them in hiding while their dear brother was brutally crucified on the cross. Yes, it's an indication, church, that these challenges come, and the road of roses that we like to walk down and think that we're going to walk down, somehow we end up stepping on some thorns. Amen. It's a journey, church, that mirrors the details of our own existence. Come on, the time that we believed this love was going to be forever.
Okay.
Then only to have our passions stepped on and wrought in the most brutal way. Or the thought that we was going to have that job forever and a day, only to see it ripped away economy, and then being laid out, or being somebody being promoted over us that wasn't even qualified. That joy then of raising children, to see them go through things such as drugs, and go through them and see these early families that they have, or even to watch them be placed in jail and have to visit them. As you talk to them, your own children, on one side of a glass, sickness in the body, depressed mental state, yet these are all difficulties that occur on the journey in which we are challenged and we continue to claim. But the encouraging thing is, yet still we are saved. That's the challenge, church. You have to be able to look at it day by day. Am I still on this Christian journey?
Yes, Lord.
These things in which we go through, can we still get through them? And can, in the midst of it, can we still praise God?
Hallelujah.
Paul carries on this, church, in this great tradition of encouragement, because he well knew his journey would continue to be wrought with disappointment and pain. The book of Romans is a doctrinal genius. If you ever study it, you will be made aware of salvation and faith and justification through the faith. But you are made aware of the spiritual forces that roam this earth and that somehow get in the midst of our body and then affect our commitment to the work of God. And ensure that we always have divisions and that break apart the body of Christ. Yet he finds time here, church, in this 8th chapter of Romans, with this spiritual battle going on, he finds the opportunity to say, I need to encourage the saints. The book begins with just this mere statement, declaration. There is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Verse 6 goes on, and it keeps going. For to be carnally minded is what, church? Death. But to be spiritually minded is what? Life and peace. Verse 18, for I reckon that the sufferings of the present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Verse 31, look, if God be for us, who can be against us? Oh, even getting down to 37, nay, in all these things we are more than loved us, only to finish off with these words, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth shall separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. That one chapter there really sets the stage to tell the people that no matter what you're going through, be encouraged. Yes, that whatever you're facing, God has not abandoned you, because there is no division, there is no principality, there is no power that can keep you away from the love of God. Yes, he takes this commercial break and declares that, look, it's going to be okay. Come on, notice in this verse. In this verse, he says it here, church. Look, he says, all good things.
All good things.
He says, all good things. Yeah, know that all things work together for good to them that love God. Amen. And that means here, church, we can't blame God for the bad stuff we do.
That's right.
Come on, talk to me, somebody.
That's right.
Come on now, you can't give me a testimony. God wanted me to go into debt, and that's why I'm better for it. Come on, talk to me, somebody. See, sometimes you got to take accountability for your mess ups. Amen. God didn't tell you. If you in debt, that means that you spent what you didn't have. So God provided you, but you just took it too far. Amen. So it means here, church. Look, God God is saying here, look, look, all good things work together, not the bad thing. Come on, the fruits of the Spirit are love, peace, joy, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. God does not raise up the poisonous saints for his glory. The body is the temple of God. So God, as the Creator, wants to be able to protect his temple. It is church. The purpose is about an accountability here, church. Right. Not blaming God for our downfalls. Right. Not blaming God. Oh, Jesus, Spirit. God want me to gossip right now. Come on. The Spirit just came over. The backstabbing Spirit just came over me right now. Look, 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 church. Look, look, look. God wants us to be able to know that with what we're going through, he is well aware. But I'm going to pull you through it. I'm going to make it work. Come on now, now. Now we can give him credit for pulling us out of it. Come on. Our hymns let us know. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deep in stain within, seeking to rise no more. But the mast of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me now safe in my love lifted me. Look, look, so who is the, look, this scripture is for the saints. The ones who got the staying power. The ones who are within this, and that even though it's difficult, even though their life is not exactly what we want it to be, I still trust God.
Yes, Lord.
That's what it's about, hey, church. That's what it's about. And we have to make our decision that even when it's not going the way that we think it should, I'm still going to praise the Lord.
That's right.
Or I'm often moved when I go into these nursing homes and I get these saints in there who just want to praise God. They have every reason not to and to be upset, but because they know the Lord in the midst of this hospital room, come on, they can raise these hands and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And the several purposes, you know, one of the several purposes that we see entire this, you know, out of this entire biblical canon, from Genesis to Revelation, encouragement ranks near the top. There was always something there. Our life is full of moments, church, in which when we were drowning, there was a hook that was thrown in to pull us out the water. Come on, that scriptural hook. Come on, look. The great stutterer, Moses, with his proclamation, he still had let my people go. Come on, even to Joshua, be strong and of good courage. These spiritual hook, these words that come and rescue us at times when we want to give up. And don't get me on the Psalms. He's a present help in times of trouble. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. They serve these opportunities. Look, look, even Christ, on his day of, you know, of dissension, with the heartbroken saints, still said, I will be with you always, even until the end of time. Paul then enters this understanding of the dedicated saints whose commitment is constantly being tested by these internal and external spiritual forces designed to eliminate, destroy, and devastate the body of Christ. Yet even through this, Christ still yells out, upon this rock I build my church. And look what he said. The gates of hell
shall not prevail.
Look, when we look at 820, you know, 828, you know, to them who are the called according to his purpose, that's us.
That's right.
The ones bold enough to still come in here with this kind of weather on Sunday morning. And still bold enough when the weather is real good and still coming in and say, I'm about to praise the Lord. Come on, talk to me, somebody. This weather may be easier than the sunny weather. Amen. Come on, talk to me, somebody. It's for us, church. It's for us that God is still working this miracle, that no matter whom we see in pews, or no matter what budgets we see, or no matter what dollars we want, God is still working the miracle, because all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord. And to them who are called according to his purpose. This is what we sign up for when we say yes, Lord. This is what we sign up for. It's the miracle that occurs when we least expect it, and God says, I'm coming to get you, and I'm pulling you out one more time. The thing when we think that we have outlived our credit with God, when we think like, God done pulled me out of so much, God is not going to show up again. I have outlived my existence. I am done. And here he comes at 11:59 and said, I've not will not leave you, nor will I forsake you. That's God. Lord, that says, I'm still here. I'm still on this battlefield. Who arises in the midst of doctor's diagnosis and times when you don't think you're coming out the hospital, God makes a way. Those of us who didn't even have a job for months, and then here comes God with a job. Amen.
Well,
all right. It's a challenge of trust. Can you trust God? I mean, can you trust? When it's going good, got it. But can you trust Him when it don't look like what you want it to look? This is the scripture that says we're not abandoned. That no matter what we go through, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. It'll be all right. Hey, look. Here, I'll leave you with this. I tell y'all so many stories about my life. I don't remember what I told you. Amen. I know. I probably told stuff 3, 4, 5 times. And I start talking, y'all be like, yeah, I remember that one. I remember that one. Yeah, you understand that one. That's the 5th time. Amen. I got to start writing them down. Did I say this one this year? Did I say this one this month? Amen. Look, when we had little Gracie and my wife had to take George to school, and so I was still working on some stuff, and so she was trying to follow my wife out the door because she wanted to go with my wife and George. And so my wife said, I was upstairs, so she said, look, I'm leaving, right? And so the door closed, amen? And I just heard this little girl just crying and screaming, amen? And so I was yelling, Gracie, I'm here. But her crying was so strong, she couldn't hear me. So she thought for those moments that she was alone, amen? She thought that she had nothing, that she had been abandoned, and that there was still no covering over her. So I had to come down the stairs. And I'm going to say this at church. There are times when you think that it's just you. And what the devil will do, he will take the lights out. It will be dark around you. And you think you won't have nothing. Right? You'll be alone in that hospital room with them lights off. You'll be at your job with a pink slip. It'll be something that will happen. And it will be no dollars in your bank account, and you got creditors coming your way, and you will feel alone. And at those few moments, my daughter felt alone. But she perked up because she heard the footsteps of her daddy. And she heard me coming down them steps. And you could tell that her cry was starting to change. And that it wasn't the same abandonment cry. It was a cry that was saying that my daddy is still here. And I came down them stairs, and that girl ran to me and hugged me, because she